Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/book-versus-movie. There are over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Thanks so much.
I shall petition. I shall put the question before the public, before the parents and the student body. You will find, Miss Mackay, that I have the loyalty of my girls. Do you, Miss Brodie?
Miss Brodie, aren't you coming to the common room?
The common room?
The celebration honoring Miss Lockhart and Mr. Lowther. Aren't you coming, Miss Brodie?
I'll be there shortly.
Hello and welcome to Back to School Book Versus Movie. This is a podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then we try to decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of ColoniaBook.com, and this is my good friend and co-host, Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hi, everyone.
So we had all 80s all August. And now it's September and we're doing all back to school books and movies for September. And I'm very excited to talk about today's book and movie. But before we get to that, if you're new, a couple things you might want to know. One, yes, we're both named Margot. We are. And I, Margot P., am on the West Coast in San Diego and Margot D. is on the East Coast in Brooklyn. And we're neither one of us experts on books or movies, so please don't use this podcast for your book report.
your thesis.
No. It's not for that. But it is for lots of fun with other people who love books and movies. And if you'd like to connect with them and us, there are lots of other places on the internet where you may do so.
Yeah. So we do have a basic Facebook page, and it's Book Versus Movie. Just look that up and we post all the episodes there. We have a Facebook group. It's a private group and it's just where we hang out and talk about the show, the current episodes, past episodes, and mostly a lot of people like to leave suggestions there for episodes in the future. So it's Book vs. Movie Podcast Group. You have to ask to join. Once again, it's a private group in Facebook. But like I said, we just talk about books and movies there and people come with really great suggestions. So if you have Facebook and you use it, we definitely say you should join it if you like the show. You could reach out to us on email at Book vs. Movie Podcast. Just spell that out at gmail.com. Our Twitter is at Book vs. A movie. You just spell that out. More people are starting to reach out to us on Instagram. I think Instagram is like the cool thing right now. So we do have a Book Versus Movie Podcast Instagram feed. We have an Audible connection. Margot and I both love Audible. We love audiobooks because we're busy people and it's a great way to, sometimes it's just a fun way to get a book is to listen to it, just to listen to a narrator and their interpretation of the work. So you just go to audibletrial.com/book-versus-movie and you can try the service for free for 1 month. And it's just like having a digital bookshelf, you know, you just get these books. They have thousands and thousands of titles. They have podcasts. It's really great. So if you're interested, audibletrial.com/book-versus-movie.
And today's book and movie is one of my favorites of all time. And so funny, I don't know why in all this time that we've been doing this podcast, I don't think I've ever, I forgot all about it until we started talking about Back to School. But today we're going to be talking about Prime of Miss Jean Brodie.
Yay!
By Muriel Spark, who I adore.
So
I'm just saying.
Well, Margot,
love,
I'm gonna. I have to say to you that this is all new to me. I've never seen this movie before. I thought I had, never seen it.
Oh,
never read it. This is my first read of it. It's my first of the material at all, and that's why I need an extra day. You and I were talking about recording yesterday. I was like, I think I need some more time to chew on this because there's a lot that's going on here. And then I started learning about the novelist Muriel Spark, and I'm like, oh my god, this woman is interesting. So it's a lot. I'm super glad though.
And one of the things, if you are new to Muriel Spark, is that yes, she tends to write her novels are short. They're quite short. But there, like Margot just said, there's a lot going on.
Yes.
It's deceptive. But yes, let's talk about Muriel Spark. I am so excited.
Okay, well, I'll give you the basics of her life. Muriel Sarah Spark, she was born in Edinburgh in 1918. She is from a Jewish and Christian home. Her father was Jewish and her mother was Anglican. She went to the James Gillespie School for Girls in 1923 to 1935. She did have some college after that. She was married in 1937 to Sydney Spark. And she followed him to Rhodesia, which is now Zimbabwe. They had a son together. His name was Robin. Turns out her husband was bipolar. They said manic depressive at the time. He was bipolar and could be violent. So,
yes, let's start over again, Margo. It was a different time.
Right.
You know, women were expected to get married quite young. So he was considerably older than she was. I think she's still a teenager, right?
Right.
When she married him. And she got pregnant like immediately. So she in this very short amount of time, she meets this older gentleman, decides to marry him, gets whisked away to Zimbabwe and gets pregnant. Just boom, boom, boom. And then discovers, yes, he's extremely unstable and violent. Wow.
So she put her son in a convent for a little while. And then all of a sudden, World War II happens. And like a lot of writers were finding out, a lot of them worked for the British intelligence during World War II. Yeah.
Yes, this is another one.
Like,
yeah.
Roald Dahl and several others were like, oh my
yeah.
God. Yeah.
And oh gosh, what's your name? James Bond. Oh, Ian Fleming.
Yep.
But I just wanted to mention again. So she's, this is the first, I think, glimpse of what an extraordinary character she was. Like I said, you know, she finds herself all of a sudden, her whole life is topsy-turvy and she's on the other side of the world from anyone who she knows and who could support her in any way. And she decides to get a divorce, which was outrageous
right.
for the time. And again, it was another time, even though he was violent and unstable, her husband got custody of her son. And so that is why she puts him, she can't, you know, when she leaves the country, partly because of the war, she can't bring her son with her, but also because she doesn't have custody of him. And so she arranges to have him put into this home. And I think eventually he's raised by his grandparents, but it creates that whole horrible situation sort of creates this wedge between her and her son that never, ever gets mended, unfortunately.
Yeah, he embraces his Jewish heritage. He's Jewish now. She becomes Church of England and then she converts to Roman Catholicism. And then that becomes like a theme in her work. But that was one of the things that they didn't agree upon. Excuse me. Their relationship was fraught. Let's just say that she made sure he was nowhere in her will when she did pass away. She met a woman and that was her companion. And there's rumors they were a romantic partnership, but she's always denied it and their friends always denied it. But she lived with this woman in Italy, in Tuscany. When she died, she left everything to this woman. And her name was Penelope Jardine. She was an artist. She was a sculptor. She was like the first woman editor of a poetry magazine. I mean, she's a poetry review. She's so many different things here. She's written so many
yeah.
things. I mean, she's like
she's extremely prolific.
Yes, that's the best way to say it.
And interestingly, again, I mean, I just find her such a fascinating character. Interestingly, I mean, she always had this drive and to be a writer. You know, she always really, really wanted to be a writer. And even when she was living, I believe when she was living in Zimbabwe, she submitted a short story to a rather prestigious journal that was having a competition and won.
Wow. You
know, this absolutely unknown writer. Yeah. So it was a kind of, I think, slightly supernatural story that takes place in Africa where she was living at the time. But yes, when she first moves to England, she's working as the editor of this poetry review, you know, journal sort of thing. And this is in the 40s, right after World War II, after her time in intelligence. And I have a really wonderful letter from her time as the editor. There's if in the prime of Miss Jean Brodie, both in the novel and in the script, there is an allusion to Marie Stopes, who was and I believe there's a movie about her as well, who was a pioneer of women's healthcare, birth control, and so on, in the early part of the 20th century. And I suppose she also must have been an aspiring poet, because it seems that she, Marie Stopes, submitted a poem to the review, and which Muriel Spark rejected. And then Marie Stopes wrote back to Muriel Spark, demanding to know, and this is 1948, demanding to know why Muriel Spark had gotten a divorce. And I want to read the letter. So Muriel Spark famously kept everything, every piece of ephemera of her life. She has a very comprehensive archive. And so there's this letter that Muriel Spark wrote in response to Marie Stopes' rather nosy question. Bear in mind, this is almost a decade before she writes The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie. And you could definitely hear Jean Brodie's voice in this letter. So let me bring it up here. I have a picture. This letter is hilarious. So it says, Madam, I have received your outrageously impudent letter of 27th May. My private affairs are no concern of yours, and your malicious interest in them seems to me to be most unwholesome. You have no right whatsoever to make inquiries about me. All inquiries necessary were made by those who appointed me and confirmed my appointment. I must say that your attitude fills me with contempt, as it would all right-thinking people. I shall give you no information about myself. I would warn you most severely, however, that your statements are libelous, and should you continue to repeat them, my solicitors will be instructed to act against you. Yours very truly, Muriel Spark.
Wow. She knows how to make a speech.
I know. Over a poem.
Oh, my God.
But I think she was very pretty and just very independent and captivating and witty. And so she seems to have had a lot of people who helped her, you know, even though it was unlikely to be, you know, trying to make a go as a female novelist or a poet even. And she was quite a successful poet also. I think she had a lot of people who recognized her talent and helped her along the way. I sort of get that impression.
She also did the work, though. I mean, she also just really was writing all the time, and she constantly was putting out great material. So she was an essayist, and she was a critic, and she was thoughtful. And that's why we're talking about her to this day. She's a super interesting person. And so I, like I said, like a week ago, I had no idea about, I've heard the name, I've heard the title, The Prime of Miss Jean Brodie. I've heard people refer to that, but I've never known exactly what it meant until I read the book. And even when I started reading the book, I'm like, okay, so it's a story. It's about a woman who's a teacher at an all-girls school. And her name's Miss Jean Brodie. And she has, for her favorite students, she kind of creates this coterie of Brodieites, that the Brodie Club, the Brodie, what are they called? The Brodie
Set.
Set. Thank you.
Yeah.
And in the book, there's several of them. She raises them from the age of 10, and then around 16, they graduate. So it's a longer time period in the book, and what they do in the movies, they combine some of the characters. But the same things are there. Brodie says art is more important than science, art and beauty and music. And then it turns out she's a fascist, and she really is like...
I know, and that's the wonderful, like, that's such a Muriel Spark thing. Like, she lures you in with what seems to be, like, when you start reading it, just like Margot said, it sort of seems like, oh, this is like a Dead Poet Society sort of a teacher that, like, teaches, opens the world of art and humanities to stodgy, stuffy Protestants, and it actually is not that at all. And one of the wonderful devices that is not employed in the movie, I don't know how you could do it, but it's a very Muriel Spark thing, is that she goes back and forth from the story, which is set in the 1930s, to how each girl what happens to her later in life. So, you know, one becomes a nun, another one dies in a fire, and so on. And she skips back and forth in time, where Miss Brodie is at her prime. Mm-hmm. And then later when she's at the end of her life, and she does it on a dime. So it catches you off guard as you're reading. And yet you take the little nugget, the little insight that she gives you into the future, and you bring it back to the story in the 1930s. It's wonderful. I think, and she does it so deftly.
There's a lot of little things going on here too. I mean, there's a lot of stuff about sex that's going on. Brodie is single, and there's two gentlemen that are kind of vying for her attention. One is Teddy Lloyd. He's the artist, and he's married with six kids, mind you. And she's has a fling with him off and on. And then there's Mr. Lowther, who is a singing teacher, and he's more quiet, more gentle, is super in love with her. And then there's this chemistry teacher. She's this kind of this sexy, interesting presence that even the girls notice her. And some of this, I think, is just about the budding sexuality and identity. But I love the part about the girls. Every once in a while, they give themselves a stain on their crisp white shirts because they want to go up to the chemistry room and be around her. So she would dot out the stain that's on their shirts. Like,
yeah, it's lovely. It's
interesting.
She, Muriel Spark, as Margot mentioned, went to a girl's school much like that. And she did have, apparently, a charismatic teacher at that time, and, you know, very, impressionable age. But that teacher was not a fascist. was a very kind and, you know, encouraged Muriel in her writing and so on. But she even said, Muriel Spark, that had her real teacher met a Miss Jean Brodie, she would have put her firmly in her place. But yes, I think she does such a wonderful job of capturing that age, don't you?
Oh, I mean, absolutely. And I think, honestly, I kept thinking, like, that's because a woman is writing this. A woman really understands what it's like to be a 10-year-old girl versus a 12-year-old girl versus, you know, there's a specificity to it that she gets. And of course, there's the giggling and there's the bonding and there's the awkwardness. But she also really understands, like, at that age, when you are kind of smart but awkward, an adult that notices you is a big deal. And an adult that you admire, like, says basically, I notice you, I see you, I see something in you. It's very captivating, and you feel special. And that's how she makes these girls feel. They feel like, oh, well, she's asking us to lunch and she's putting us in her set and all that and all that. But, you know, part of the story is that she is admiring fascists who are horrible, terrible people.
And she introduces it slowly. Like, yes. Muriel Spark, you know, just there's like these little, like, you know, we're talking about art and beauty and poetry. And then she just slips in there like, oh, and of course, Mussolini.
There's no litter on the streets because he took care of that. And the girl's like, oh, that sounds great.
Sure. They get all swept up in it.
Yes.
I love the way that she kind of just quietly feeds in the fascism as the story progresses. You know, that's the first little like, you know, it's wonderful.
And one of the girls is Sandy. She is one of the ones that in the book, it's Jenny who has the affair with Teddy. I'm sorry, Mr. Lloyd, right? The artist. It wasn't Sandy. In the movie, it's Sandy. Well, we'll talk about the movie, in a second.
Yeah, no, again, because there are more girls in the book than there are in the movie.
Right.
There's a little bit of mixing and matching that happens in the movie.
With their personalities and what happens to them. And like Margot says, they go back and forth in time, but Sandy says, and she says this a couple of times, she thinks she is Providence, which is just like that she's a Calvinist, like she is chosen by God. And this woman choosing you makes you extra special because she has been chosen to be special herself. And also that Miss Jean is in her prime. So we're thinking like her 40s. She's sort of at the best time in her life, her most exciting, her most desirable. And she's got these two men kind of vying for her time and her attention and her heart. But she's having more fun kind of playing everybody along. And she doesn't really form real attachments. It's kind of, it, you know, because she's kind of seeing herself as separate from them. And that's what the girls are starting to realize. Some of them do, not all of them do, but a couple of them in the end, they reject her theories and they reject her. Mm-hmm. But one of her things, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, not just Sandy. But one of the things I think is really interesting, I mean, Muriel Spark is this wonderful, again, it's this divide, this like push and pull of, she shows you like, oh, this is who the character is. She's, you know, she thinks Miss Brodie is this like special, she's in her prime, you know, art and beauty, and she travels to Europe, da 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 da. And then right, she'll turn right around on a dime, Muriel Spark will, and say, but actually, she's not that unusual. She's not that extraordinary. There are armies of women like this all over Edinburgh. And you're like, whoa. And she's, you know, she's saying that, you know, there was this whole, that Miss Brodie was part of this generation of women who, you know, in their kind of marrying years, it was World War I, and all of their boyfriends and fiancés were killed. And so you have this generation of spinsters.
Mm-hmm.
And she is just a quintessential example of that. She's not an anachronism at all. In fact, it's great, I think. But the girls are completely, you know, for a time, they're completely sucked into that.
Well, so much so that she kind of says, like, you're going to be known for sex. You're going to be known for your brains. You're going to be known for being kind. You're going to be a good spy one day. She has them all their roles worked out for her. And then as a proxy, she's sending one of them to be Sandy in the book to be the lover of Mr.
Oh,
Lloyd.
It's Rose.
Oh, Rose. I'm sorry, Rose. Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Who's not in the movie at all?
Right.
In the movie, they make Rose and Jenny the same character, but in the book, it's Rose who is so captivating and so beautiful and is going to be known for sex, surely, because Miss Brodie says so.
Because she says so. And by the way, we have to talk about. I mean, because this is. I mean, I don't know. If we're talking about teenagers that, you know, she's telling her to have an affair with a man who's in his 40s. And
yes,
I mean, yeah. And to do that as her proxy. And then she wants one
like
of the.
What? She's pimping this her student yes. out, basically. Yes. So she's a fascist and a pimp.
And yeah, she is. She's manipulative. I mean,
yeah,
she's really manipulative. And that's something like that some of them catch on to and some of them don't. What happens also is that she is fired from her job and then you're sort of left like, well, what happened to her? And she basically, within about 10 years, she dies of cancer. And so some of the girls are sort of just thinking about her in the past and what sort of effect she had upon them and their lives in total.
And they're reflecting on it. And just like in the book, it takes place, like Margot said, over a longer period of time. But what happens is, we learn early on that she was fired because one of her own girls betrayed her. And each of the girls in later life recount, you know, seeing Miss Brodie in her retirement and that Miss Brodie would go on and on and trying to discern who was it that betrayed me. Mm-hmm. I don't think it was so-and-so because she said this. And I don't think it was this girl because of that, but maybe it was this girl and going and ruminating and obsessing about it for the rest of her life. And I love there's this moment, it's about three quarters of the way through the story, where Sandy is Sandy, who eventually becomes a nun.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the book, she's a nun. But before that, she's also now it's her turn to have a retirement, you know, luncheon with Miss Brodie, and Miss Brodie's going on and on about who betrayed her. And Muriel Spark says Sandy is bored to tears because, you know, it had been so many years since she betrayed this tiresome woman. I mean, and it just, and Muriel Spark does that all the time, where she'll just plunk, she'll just like get you right between the eyes with the truth and then just move on.
Yeah.
It's great. It's great.
Yeah. I super loved it. It's a quick read too, you guys. And then there's also, I believe it's free, the version that I found on Audible. You guys should check it out because I thought it was just wonderful. It's a weird, but I have to say, it's a weird story. You just don't know where it's going to go. She says things that are just like, you're like, excuse me, you're talking to kids? What are you doing? I don't know, but I still found it enjoyable.
Yeah. I just think Muriel Spark is such a fascinating writer. I can see why people just we're just obsessed with her. I mean, she prolific and always unexpected, and this book is such a great example of it. And it was a huge hit.
Yes.
It was a massive hit when it came out. And so it wasn't long before it was adapted into a very successful stage play.
And that starred Vanessa Redgrave. And I think Julie Andrews did it for a little while, but that it was adapted as a stage play. And then it did so well in New York and in London that they turned it into a movie. And Vanessa Redgrave had said she had other obligations, but she also said she was just tired of this fascist character. Vanessa Redgrave is a rather political person herself, and she didn't want to play it. And Ronald Nemeth later said, well, I didn't want her to do it anyway. And he wanted Maggie Smith. And should we play the trailer?
Yes.
Okay, here's the trailer. It's about 3 minutes, you guys, because there's...
It's long.
It's long. Because the song Jean by Rod McCune is... I think the whole song is in the same. But anyway, let's play that.
Jean, roses are red, all the leaves are laundry.
I am in the business of putting old heads on young shoulders, and all my pupils are the creme de la creme. Give me a girl at an impressionable age, and she is mine for life. I am dedicated to you in my prime.
Ah, the dangerous Miss Brodie.
She always looks so extreme.
We will have to watch Miss Brodie's stomach.
Oh, Miss Brodie, you are dangerous.
I would deem it a sincere service to the school if any indiscretion that might reach your ear should also reach mine.
There's a special kind of woman who will always cause people to talk.
Miss Brodie's really in love with Mr. Lloyd, but he's married to another. So she's working it off on Mr. Lowther.
I don't understand, Eugene. You will not marry me, and yet you feed me and share my bed.
Share your bed? Why can't you say you are my lover?
The truth, Jean, is that you bounced into bed with an artist, but you were horrified when you woke up with a man.
Now, a special kind of woman is at the heart of a special kind of motion picture.
You girls are my life now. Soon you will graduate and I will no longer teach you, but you will always be Brodie girls.
First he puts out the light, then their toes touch, then Miss Brodie, Miss Brodie. Miss Brodie says, darling.
Come back, Jane. I need you.
Is this what your girls, your set, has learned under your auspices, Miss Brodie?
I am a teacher. I am a teacher first, last, always. Do you imagine that for one instant I will let that be taken from me without a fight? I have dedicated, sacrificed my life to this profession, and I will not stand by like an inky little slacker and watch you rob me of it.
Out of one Jean Brodie comes a whole rebellious generation of Jean Brodies. Out of the Broadway and London stage smash hit has come a motion picture masterpiece. It stars the extraordinary Maggie Smith as Miss Jean Brodie.
How much longer are you going to be tempted by this firm young flesh?
All to your 18 and over the hill.
Hey, Teddy, take me dancing.
Certainly not.
What a coward.
A man with a wife and six children, plus a schoolgirl for a mistress, can be called any number of rude names, but coward is not one of them.
You really are a shallow girl. You really are a ridiculous woman. By the way, she died. Mary McGregor illumined her life. She died a heroine.
She died a fool.
How dare you speak to me in this manner?
All the leaves have gone green, and the hills are ablaze with the morning haze. Come into my arms, Bonnie Jean.
Our director is Ronald Neame. He was a producer, a writer, a director. He was in show business. He had a very active career. You can look up his IMDb credits. He lived to be 99, by the way, which I always think that's amazing. He won the Palme d'Or at Cannes in 1969 for this movie. So I'll just go through the cast really quick. We have Maggie Smith. I think we all know who Maggie Smith is. It's fun.
Perhaps you've heard of her.
It's fun to see her young. I mean, she keeps, I mean, I've been watching all of her films forever, like my whole life.
Yeah.
And she's still out there, but she's 35 when she did this. She's with her husband at the time, Robert Stevens. He mm-hmm. plays Teddy Lloyd. Pamela Franklin plays Sandy. And a few of our listeners said on the Facebook group, you know, she's also in The Legend of Hell House and Satan's School for Girls. So we do need to remember that. Gordon Jackson is Mr. Lowther. Celia Johnson is Miss Mackay. We have Diane Grayson as Jenny. We have Jane Carr as Mary McGregor. Mary McGregor breaks my heart.
Oh, I know. Oh. Isn't she wonderful? I think she's so great. Yeah.
And Shirley Steedman as Monica. And Miss McKenzie is Isla Cameron. This movie, it wasn't a huge hit, I don't think, in the States. But in 1970s, because the Oscars always come out, you know, the year later, she won for Best Actress. I put the clip in the Book vs. Movie podcast group and Facebook, excuse me. And she, Alice Ghostly, accepted her award for her. Yes. I guess they were friends.
Alice Ghostly. I love her.
Oh, God, please, please. Designing Women? Yes, she's great. So they have four girls that are kind of our main girls versus six or whatever that it was. And they basically kind of condensed this to maybe a year. And the girls now are about 16, 17. And mm-hmm. I mean, some of the actresses, I think the actresses were between like 18 and 21. I mean, one of them was a mother, was a 20-year-old mother.
Yeah, they kind of very quickly establish the early part of their relationship where the girls, and it's not that convincing of them playing these like super young ages, but right. You know, they do their best and they kind of get to where the action really happens when they're much older. Yeah, I saw a screen test. Angela Cartwright.
Yes, I saw that too.
Yeah, did you see that? And she's very good.
She's great in everything. Yeah.
Yeah. Although Pamela, what's her name? Pamela?
Franklin.
Franklin is extraordinary in this. Yeah, she's, I mean, everybody is so great. And I heard that Muriel Spark's one criticism of the film was that she said it made Edinburgh look too colorful and beautiful, that, you know, in the 30s, it was quite a drab, dark, gray, coal-covered place. And so therefore, Miss Brodie, like, really stands out as this colorful peacock figure, and that the movie is a little too pretty.
I agree with her. I think that's why they made the girls' uniforms gray and white, was to try to take some of the shine away from Maggie. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like to enhance Maggie Smith. But there's a couple of times, and I love Robert Stevens. He's such a shit in this movie. He's horrible.
He's so awful. He's great.
But he's great. I mean, he and Maggie Smith, their scenes together, like, wow, they have a lot of chemistry.
They sure do.
They do, but he doesn't look 1931 to me. He looks 1969.
He really does. Yeah. The hair.
The hair, please.
The hair, yeah.
The open shirt, the things like that.
And
I mean,
the tan. He's quite tan for Edinburgh.
That's a good point. Yes. But he plays the artist, and he's, oh my, you could not make this now. It's the way he touches these all the girls and talks to them is so lecherous. And
it's gross.
It's
so,
I mean, I have to just kind of like, maybe trigger warning. I mean, this guy, because there's no consequences. I mean, he just gets to do whatever he wants. Yeah.
None. And you can't help but think like, oh, how many years has he been doing that?
Yeah.
You know, groping and just picking and choosing these girls.
And then grabbing Maggie Smith. It just grabs her and throws her into a room and starts kissing her.
Yeah.
It's just like, it's white male privilege on display. Ugh. Yeah, he's pretty gross, but great. I mean, it makes him perfect for the part. And then we have Gordon, who's Mr. Lowther, who's so lovely and sweet. Gordon Jackson was in Mutiny on the Bounty, and he was in The Great Escape. He's had like
upstairs,
downstairs for years. He's great. And he is a good, you know, you could see why she's attracted to him and wanting to spend weekends with him, but he's also a bit of a weak character. you know, he just lets Gene Brody walk all over him and tell him what to do. Mm-hmm. And so he winds up marrying the chemistry teacher because he needs to marry somebody. And he'd rather marry her, but she's not the marrying type. We're getting the idea. And the girls, I mean, I think it's, so when Sandy is the one, well, first we have to say, like, Jane Carr's Mary McGregor, who's this awkward girl who stutters, is so sweet and so innocent, and she kind of gets more courage as she goes along. But Sandy is the one, you can see her wheels are turning. She's the smartest and she's the sharpest, mm-hmm. and she's constantly like taking information in and figuring things out. And she's the one that first she has an affair with an affair. I mean, what am I saying? This man cannot, right? She's a child. I mean,
indeed.
You know, but that's this movie, too. And this is, I think, a man as a director kind of being like, oh, well, you know, as soon as she has sex, she's acting like she's had sex forever, like her whole life. She's like super casual and comfortable about it. That's like, that was always the thing with Flashdance, that movie Flashdance. Like, supposedly she was a virgin and then she met this guy. And then like the next day, she's like the sexiest thing in the world. Like, hey, I'm good at this. I don't know. But I think it's a way of taking responsibility off of him and to make her so casual about it. But They have sex, they have a relationship, and then she's the one in the end. I mean, we see Maggie Smith has these several times of a couple of big scenes where she and the headmaster are clashing, and it's because she's teaching things she doesn't think. Like, she puts a picture of an Italian, just, you know, painter over the sign that we believe in safety first. She goes, we do not believe in safety first. And boom.
This poster, it's a Giotto poster over the prime minister's picture, I think.
Yes. And
I think it's the prime minister. You would safety first. It's the safety.
Yeah, she doesn't have a lot of respect for the prime minister. And she's, and there's a few scenes, and the girls are very obedient. They just want, they, you know what it's like to be that age and a teacher you think is cool. You just, you know, you think everything they do is amazing. Her clothes are so beautiful and she wears them so well.
Her wardrobe.
Oh my God. She's so beautiful in this movie. It's just ridiculous. But she has a great scene with Miss Mackay, is it? That she, the first showdown that she has where she's, you know, she's demanding that she
gives her a telling off.
Yes.
For the ages.
I will not resign. You will not resign. You will force me to dismiss you. I will not resign, and you will not dismiss me, Miss Mackay. You will not use the excuse of that pathetic, that humorous document to blackmail me. Mr. Lowther, you are a witness to this. Miss Mackay has made totally unsupported accusations against my name and yours. If she has one authentic shred of evidence, just one, let her bring it forth. Otherwise, if one more word of this outrageous calumny reaches my ears, I shall sue. I shall take Miss Mackay to the public courts, and I shall sue the trustees of Marcia Blaine if they support her. I will not stand quietly by and allow myself to be crucified by a woman whose fetid frustration has overcome her judgment. If scandal is to your taste, Miss Mackay, I shall give you a feast. Miss Brodie, I am a teacher. I am a teacher first, last, always. Do you imagine that for one instant I will let that be taken from me without a fight? I have dedicated, sacrificed my life to this profession, and I will not stand by like an inky little slacker and watch you rob me of it. And for what? For what reason? For jealousy? Because I have the gift of claiming girls for my own. It is true, I am a strong influence on my girls. I am proud of it. I influence them to be aware of all the possibilities of life, of beauty, honor, courage. I do not, Miss Mackay, influence them to look for slime where it does not exist. I am going. When my class convenes, my pupils will find me composed and prepared to reveal to them the succession of the Stuarts. And on Sunday, I will go to Cramond to visit Mr. Lowther. We are accustomed, bachelor and spinster, to spend our Sundays together in sailing and walking the beaches and in the pursuit of music. Mr. Lowther is teaching me to play the mandolin. Good day, Miss Mackay.
And then she tries to get Jenny is her name in the movie, Diane Grayson. She's the prettiest one. She tries to get her to have an affair. And on this, and Lloyd, Mr. Lloyd, he's always painting, but all of his pictures have Miss Brodie's face on them, no matter what he's doing. That's what we're meant to think. So Jenny's getting her picture taken with him. But it, like I said, it's Sandy who poses nude. who has, like I said, has a relationship with him. And it kind of, she's the one that sees, well, so in the movie, Mary McGregor is encouraged by Miss Brodie to fight in Spain.
The Spanish Civil War.
Right.
Yeah, for Franco.
And so.
The dictator.
The dictator. And she dies on her way there.
Yeah.
And Sandy sees that, okay, she's upset about it, but not really nearly as upset as she should be because she didn't really know her.
Yes.
And so then Sandy's the one that kind of is, and you think about like what an amazing scene it is when she confronts her. It's like 10 minutes of Maggie Smith and Pamela Franklin. Yeah. And Pamela Franklin's like 17 or 18 years old at the time. Mm. She's just holding her own. I mean, she's really, but she calls her out for all of her bullshit for all those years.
I don't understand. I don't seem to understand what has happened to everyone. Where is everyone gone?
Only Mary is gone.
Mary? What has Mary to do with it?
Miss Brodie, Mary McGregor is dead. Are you aware of the order of importance in which you place your anxieties? One, you have been betrayed. Two, who is or is not to be your proxy in Teddy Lloyd's bed? And three, Mary's death. Miss Brodie, aren't you concerned at all with Mary's death?
I grieve for Mary.
It was because of you she went.
Because of me, it was her brother. The poor unfortunate girl hadn't anyone else in the world.
She had you. That was her misfortune. To please you, that silly, stupid girl ran off and got herself killed. Don't you feel responsible for that?
No. No, I feel responsible for giving her ideals. The ideals that sent her to Spain. I feel responsible for teaching her that service to a cause is a privilege.
You call it a privilege to be killed? And for nothing. Nothing!
You really are a shallow girl, Sandy. By the way, she died. Mary McGregor illumined her life. She died a heroine.
She died a fool. Joining her brother to fight for Franco, wasn't that just like Mary? Her brother is fighting for the other side.
Her brother
is fighting for the Republicans. Mary was headed for the wrong army.
Oh, Mary McGregor.
Mary McGregor. I used to wonder why I always called Mary by her full name. I think it was because you had such a hard time remembering who she was. Poor dim Mary.
And then that's the reason why she leaves. And we don't really know what happens after that. But because then all of a sudden it just goes, Jean.
Okay.
I guess that's it. And then scene. And I would say this. So the first time I watched it, I'm not sure how I felt about it. And then the second time, I noticed the push the button for closed captioning because sometimes I couldn't understand what people were saying. They're talking very fast. And is she supposed to have a Scottish accent or no?
Yes, she is. So I think Maggie Smith, one of her parents was Scottish. And of course, she is Professor McGonagall.
Yes, she is.
We all know. But I believe what she's doing in this movie is that she's, and I think there's a little bit of that, it mentions it in the book, that she, yes, she's from Edinburgh. She's very proud to be Scottish, but we're also to understand from her accent that she is someone who chooses to live in Scotland. She's traveled all over. She has a slight like British tinge to her accent to show her worldliness.
Mm-hmm.
But so we're to understand, yes, she's here in Scotland by choice, you know, not because she's a spinster who works in this old school. You know, she's quite cultured and worldly and so she's not a regular Scottish spinster. So I think if she had wanted to do like the thickest Edinburgh accent of all, she could. But it's a choice to be slightly different than everybody else.
Well, that makes sense. Because I can understand it easier than a Scottish accent. But mm-hmm. I had a hard time what anybody was saying. So it was helpful for me to have the captions to watch it the second time. And then I think I noticed it better, like certain underpinnings that are happening in the script. I mean, they don't capture everything. And there was a 7-part series that came out, I think, in the BBC, but it was available on Acorn TV, but I couldn't get it. But there was a TV series.
I couldn't find it either. Yeah.
1978. And I tried on Amazon. I've looked at YouTube. And she said that the author, Muriel Spark, said that was her favorite version. But I guess, like, you have 7 hours there to really tell the story.
Do. Yeah. And you get more of course, each girl
mm-hmm.
and their lives. I feel like the script does a good job of taking the essence of the book, you know, and condensing it into the time frame that we have for a play or a movie. But like Mary McGregor in the movie is actually two characters. She's Mary McGregor and
You dropped out there. So you were saying that she was two characters in the book.
In the book, she's Emily and Mary. And Mary in the book dies in a fire. And it's this sad scene.
Oh, horrible.
That, isn't it awful? It's so sad that she's in a hotel, I think, mm-hmm. and that catches fire. And she panics. And instead of escaping, she just runs back and forth from one end of the fire to the other, one end of the fire to the other. And that's how she dies. I mean, it's so sad that she kind of doesn't have the sense or the presence of mind to just get out of there, which she could have done. And the whole thing about Sandy being a nun. So Sandy grows up and she publishes quite a well-known book on psychology. And then becomes, or I don't remember if she's a nun when she writes it. It's a pivotal work on psychology.
Mm-hmm.
And then she becomes this kind of cloistered nun. Scholars come to visit her. And of course, her former classmates come to visit her in the convent where she's cloistered away. So there's all this other fun stuff that you get to see about the girls and Jean Brodie that you don't get in the movie at all. But I think, you know, you just couldn't do... It would have to be like a 7-part miniseries. You couldn't possibly do it in a 2-hour film or play.
No, so it's missing because of that. I mean, you're getting the Cliff's Notes version of the story, even though the story is pretty sparse, but she puts so much detail. And I love it, like Muriel Spark, I love her writing. Like, she does throw shade every once in a while, but in just a really smart way. And it's very clever. And I think, I was really kind of upset because I couldn't get my hands on that other version because I wanted to at least like check it out for a little bit to see like how this other woman would play her. But I think Maggie, this is my problem. Like, Maggie Smith is so damn charismatic. Like, I just like her. Even when Jean's being terrible, I still kind of like, and it's great casting, I guess, because I'm on the, you know, Jean train. I just think she's incredible.
She is, and you get sucked in. And this is, I would say this is more true of the movie than it is of the book, that you do kind of get sucked in to the charisma of Jean Brodie. I think just because Maggie Smith, as you said herself, is so charismatic that you kind of don't stand a chance because she's just, you can't stop looking at her and her beautiful dresses and it's just the way that she speaks and tells people off, and it's just wonderful.
I looked it up. She's 5'5". I've always thought of Maggie Smith as like this very tall person just because of the way she carries herself. Like,
yes.
I thought she was like 5'10 or something, and it's like, and she's 5'5". Like, that's just how much charisma she has. Like, she just fills up a space with just her personality and her aura. And she's won 2 Oscars. She's been nominated, I looked up, over 100 times for acting, just in movies. That's not counting stage. I mean, just, that's TV and movies. I mean, just, come on.
I could watch her all day long. I mean, we talked about her briefly in our last episode on A Room with the View, but she's just always extraordinary. And this is, I mean, this is, I don't know if I would say it's her, because it's not like she's diminished after Miss Jean Brodie.
No.
But if there's one role that I feel like is the quintessential Maggie Smith role, it is definitely this one.
I get it now.
I mean, she just, it is a tour de force, as they say.
Yeah. I totally agree. I super, super loved it. So I can't decide between the book and the movie. I have to think about it. Like, what do you think?
I know. For me, it's a tie. Oh, and I should say, too, in the book, Miss Jean Brodie is dark. She's, like, got dark, brooding features and dark hair and dark eyes. She doesn't look anything like Maggie Smith. She stands out in the book because she's got these dark features. But in the movie, Maggie Smith, just with her wardrobe and her persona and her whole aura is just this, like, incandescent glowing.
Right.
You know, just, you can't take your eyes off of her. And then when she's speaking, it's just like the scene I love. I think my favorite scene in the movie with her is when she's trying to keep it together and she's sharing her vacation slides with the students and she's trying not to cry.
Yeah.
Monitors, the blinds, please. Clara, will you pull down the screen? I also spent 2 weeks in Egypt, where people do not believe in God, but in Allah. Catherine, will you switch on the light, please? The bottom left-hand side. I have brought you these slides at my own expense. The girls at the back may sit up on their desks. Rome. This is a large formation of Il Duce's fascisti. They are following him in noble destiny. I myself mingled with such a crowd. I wore my silk dress with red poppies, which is right for my colouring. Benito Mussolini, Il Duce, Italy's leader supreme, a Roman worthy of his heritage, the greatest Roman of them all. The Colosseum, where Christian slaves were thrown to the lions and gladiators fought to the death. Ave imperato morituri te salutamus. Hail Caesar, those who are about to die salute thee. Florence, the David of Michelangelo. That is the original David. He's in the Galleria dell'Accademia di Belle Arti. There's a copy in the Piazza della Signoria, next to the Palazzo Vecchio. He is there for any passerby to gaze upon and be uplifted. He is at once the glory of the past and the inspiration of the future. David, the young warrior.
And she talks about, and I love this line in the book too. It was maybe my favorite line in the book. And so maybe that's why it's my favorite scene in the movie, where she talks about how she went to go see, I can't remember if it was Mussolini or Franco, and that she wore her dress with the red poppies, which is right for her coloring. And she's just been destroyed, but she's trying to keep it together she's telling herself that she's trying to keep it together for these girls. But in fact, she's trying to keep it together just for her own pride and ego. And just all the stuff that's going on in that scene with the slideshow, I think is so brilliant.
It is.
So for me, I think it's a tie, I have to say, because the book is just spectacular.
I agree. And I'm going to also keep on top of that other version from 1978 to see if I can ever watch it, because I think I'm just really interested in other ways of presenting the character and the story. I just, I'm really, really intrigued by it now.
Yeah, me too. So yeah, I mean, I love this book and movie. I hadn't seen it in many, many years. I remember the first time I read it and saw it, I was probably the same age as the girls.
Oh, wow.
And now I'm older than Brodie.
I know.
In the story. I think I wonder if reading this book at an impressionable age as I did, if it didn't influence my skeptical eye that I developed over the years. But it was so fun for me to go back and read it. And I've read it once or twice in the interim. I love it more. Every time I read it, I enjoy it more. There's more stuff that I see in this very short book. There are more layers there that I didn't see before. And that's the wonderful thing about Muriel Spark, I think.
Yeah. And I the second time I watched the movie, I enjoyed it more. There was more I got out of it. So that's what great work is. Yeah.
It's great. It's great. And it's on YouTube for free.
Yes. I put a link on
there. You don't even have to pay for it. Yeah. Oh, and I found a wonderful, I'll put this in the group, in the Facebook group. I found a wonderful collection of photographs of Edinburgh in the mid 1930s.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and there's a bunch of stuff like with school children and, oh, can you hear that?
No, what was that?
Oh, my phone, there's an emergency alert. There's a terrible wildfire. There's a terrible wildfire in San Diego, and I guess they're doing evacuations now. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my goodness, Margo.
I hope those people are safe. Yeah, yeah. It's not near me at all, but it is in our county. I was just saying before we got on the air, it's probably 30 miles away from me, and the ash is falling all the way over here where I am. So I hope those people are safe. I got completely distracted by that. It was a very loud, like an emergency alert would be.
No, I didn't hear a thing.
Oh, I'm glad you couldn't hear it because it was quite loud. So we are going to continue with Back to School in September. We have some really fun selections. Which one do you think we should do next?
Well, should I mention what we're thinking of first?
Yeah.
Okay, so we have Lord Selma. I have two copies of this. I ordered two of them by accident. I'm going to see if it's on Disney. But did you want to pair that with the movie Selma?
Yes. Okay. It was a made-for-TV movie.
But it's the made for TV movie that's based on this isn't available.
Oh.
So yeah. Selma is a whole different thing.
Oh, we may have to rethink that. But you can't find it, I see.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let's put that on the back burner and see if we can track it down then.
Okay. So put that on the back burner. But the other ones we have coming up are Clueless, a redo. We have two redos, Clueless and Perks of Being a Wallflower.
Oh, yeah. Oh, let's do Clueless.
Yes, let's do Clueless next, and you and I will work out this Selma stuff.
Or we
might have to move that to February or something. We'll figure that out.
We may have to, but we'll see.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's it. That's Clueless is the next one. We're pairing that with Emma, the book. The movie, we've all seen this movie 100 times, and you'll watch it 100 times more. It's really, really adorable and fun. So I can't wait to talk about this again. You can find us wherever you
get
your podcast. Yes, we do. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts. If you get it through Apple Podcasts, if you leave us a 5-star review, we'll mention you on the air. We have a Patreon page. And on it, Margo and I have all of our... We've been doing this for 6 years now. It was 6 years ago that we started this. And our older episodes are behind the Patreon wall. We have very affordable options. At the $3 and $5 level, you can listen to those old episodes. There's like 60 of them there. Some of them are for free, so you could check that out and see if you want to help. And the money just helps us put together the costs for the show, hosting a show every week, that kind of thing. So to go to patreon.com and look up Book vs. Movie Podcast if you're interested. And you could, like I said, find us wherever you get your podcast. Subscribe. You'll never miss an episode. Follow us on social media. And Margo, where can they find you?
You can find me on the internet at coloniabook.com, and all of my social media callouts are at She's Nacho Mama. And where can they find you?
You can find me on social media at Brooklyn Fit Chick, and that's for Twitter and Instagram. And my blog is brooklynfitchick.com. And guys, we'll be back next week with Clueless/Emma. Thank you so much for listening to the Book vs. Movie Podcast. We're a part of the Electronic Media Collective. And we follow the hashtags Potter and Family and Lady Pod Squad. You can find us on social media at Book vs. a Movie. You just spell that all out for Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. You can send us an email at bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. If you want to join our Facebook group, look for us under Book vs. Movie Podcast Group in Facebook. Ask to join, and you may be lucky enough to get in. We also have a Patreon page if you want to support the show. Go to patreon.com. and look for Book vs. Movie Podcast. We record the show with our handy H6N, donated by those of you who were nice enough to contribute to the Patreon page. Thanks so much, and we'll be back soon with a new episode.
Come out of your heart, dream, dream. And run it. To the top of the hill, open your arms, Bonnie Jean, till a sheep in the valley come home I'll wait, till the stars fall around me and find me alone, when the sun comes a singing, I'll still be waiting. you know the leaves have gone green, and the hills are ablaze with the morning.